This is the Samsung Galaxy S24. And I'll start off by saying that I was not initially planning to do a video on this, since the highlight of the S24 series has always been the Plus or the Ultra. And after using this for a month as my daily driver smartphone, honestly, I was not prepared for this. Now first off, for context, the variant that I have been using is the base 8GB of RAM with 256GB of storage, which currently starts at 4099 ringgit here in Malaysia, or about 856 USD. And the color that I went with is the amber yellow. And yes, this is the variant of the Exynos 2400 chipset, so is that a problem? Let's find out, shall we? So design-wise, the curves and the angles of the phone all look and feel great in the hand. It is indeed super refreshing feeling and holding a smaller size phone that fits nicely in your pocket. And because of the smaller size form factor, I found myself taking out the phone and taking a quick photo way faster because it's smaller compared to a bigger size phone. And while this is not a feature, I just love how the phone can stand on its own. The little great things in life. Now the lovely thing is that it has Corning Gorilla Glass Victus 2, which surely makes this one of the most durable smartphones for a compact phone. And the matte finish at the back feels very premium since it does not attract any fingerprints at all. And yes, like its elder sibling, it is also IP68 rated too. And while almost nobody talks about this, I love how there's no sort of a camera island or a camera bump surrounding the lenses, where it's just the lenses, bam, and that's it. It is very clean and it does give a very minimalist look to the phone. So yes, the S24 not only looks cool, but it feels good in the hands. I know that sounds very cliche, but that is true. And this alone is why I love the phone. And if you haven't held it, go to your nearest Samsung store and try it. Trust me, you'll love it. So the 6.2-inch dynamic 2x AMOLED display is slightly larger than last year's S23. It has a smooth 120Hz scrolling that adapts to what you're doing. So if you're reading something idly or just casually browsing, the refresh rate will adjust to as low as possible, hence saving battery. And if you're scrolling fast like a TikTok king or queen, it will also adjust the refresh rate accordingly. Now the vivid and the natural mode bug is still here, where in case you do not know that the current issue that a lot of people are facing, where you won't see a significant changes when switching between both modes. Now before you judge the phone based on that, let me ask you this, how often do you change these modes in your phone anyway? For me, the screen looks fantastic out of the box, and I have been using Samsung phones for more than a decade, and I have never touched the settings, and it is still one of the best smartphone displays till date. Then the fully flat display is something that really needs to be highlighted, not only from a video consumption point of view, but also just using the phone as a phone, especially with the slimmer bezels too. Now there's always that sort of confidence when using the phone in one hand. From navigating to all edges were great, from swiping down from the notification menu to doing any gesture style controls for the navigation, since I switched my menu system to the gesture navigation instead of the virtual menu ever since Samsung introduced the gesture navigations many years ago. And the good news is that the display was still nice and visible even when I was out in a bright daylight, taking up to 8K video with barely any warmth to the phone, and more on the thermal performance on the phone later on in this video. Then the fingerprint sensor is also something really worth shouting about, because I never had a single miss unlock ever. And this is of course also because of the smaller size form factor, which is also on a natural position of your fingers when you're unlocking it. Now as for the cameras, here's where I feel that the camera's quality could be the deciding factor for you to really consider getting this phone. Because even though you're getting a 50 megapixel instead of a massive 200 megapixel on the Ultra for the main lenses, I personally feel that the image quality on this phone was really great. So the high megapixel mode has 5 focal length, where essentially it crops from the 50 megapixel sensor, and this would be useful if you want to get the best amount of pixels in every shot. However, keep in mind that you're getting an average of 9 to 16 megabytes per photo when using the main lens, so use it wisely. Then the ultra-wide lenses also look amazing with fantastic dynamic range with no barrel distortion at the sides. They are still one of the best ultra-wide lenses in the market today. Then the overall image quality for the main lenses were flawless as seen in these images over here. Then the optical lenses go up to 3x since there is a dedicated 10 megapixel camera for that. And then as for the digital zoom, when it goes beyond 20x zoom, it locks the subject way better using the camera's AI integration, something that only Samsung phone does brilliantly compared to any other smartphone. smartphones out right now. And the overall image quality was decent during bright daylight, of course. Then the portrait mode has three levels of 1x to 3x, where for objects, it has a great separation between the subject to background blur. But for more complicated objects, the edge detection can be sometimes a little miss. But the 3x portrait mode seems to work best from a focal length and edge detection point of view. Then for portrait mode for humans, overall is better when it comes to getting the portrait look. And one thing I've noticed is that the 2x portrait mode seems to focus on the background by default compared to the 1x or the 3x zoom. So keep in mind that you'll need to touch the subject to focus to ensure that this does not happen to you. We end up focusing on the background instead of the subject, so hopefully a software update could fix that. Then selfie shots were superb as expected, whether or not you're taking regular selfies or portrait selfie, with impressive dynamic range and best skin tones as well. Now, using the 50 megapixel mode at night wouldn't bring a huge difference in terms of the overall image quality, so I would just recommend to sticking to the regular night mode instead, where the ultra wide lenses did a very good job over here as well. But of course, since the main lens has a bigger sensor, you'll get an overall nicer results when using the main lens. Then the portrait mode at night really looked flawless, to my surprise, because both humans and objects were looking really great, but has a similar focus quirk on the 2x zoom for humans. But once you lock in the focus, it performs exceptionally well. Now, another surprise was the night selfie mode, where the regular and the portrait mode did an amazing job too. And while there is a night mode for this selfie mode, I personally do not like the images over here, since it has a little of a HDR effect that brings out a different look to my white shirt and my skin tones too. And the oil on my face. Then of course, a lovely treat is that the S24 has 8K 30fps recording, which is great from a video quality perspective, but also is at the right frame rate, 30fps instead of 24fps, so people who's shooting in 24. Keep that in mind. The image stabilization is also heavily improved too, which means that not only you're getting a very high quality video, but very stable footages as well. And knowing the fact that this small size phone is an 8K beast, it really shows the capability of the phone that you're getting in the results, not only during the day, but also at night as well. And of course, the 4K video footage for the ultra-wide lenses, the main lenses were amazing during the day and also at night. And while you can go up to 12x zoom in this 4K mode, but you will see some noise in this high digital zoom. So the max that I would recommend to get the best quality when it comes to video is only at 10x instead. Oh, speaking of zoom, there is a little hack that if you want to record at a higher zoom level at 8K, by default you can't. But what you can do is to start at 4K 3x zoom and then switch to the resolution at 8K, and you can. You're welcome. Then as for the front cameras, during the day it was amazing with flawless stabilization, and the same can be said for the video recording at night as well. And here's an audio recording using the front camera, like a vlogging situation, including a wind noise test. So let me know what you think. Alright, so this is a video test and also a vlogging test on how the S24 works and sounds at the same time. Now, one of the best things about this particular phone is the fact that it is smaller in size, so you can just like typically put it in your pocket, just whoop it out and take a quick video. Whether or not it's for vlogging, it's Instagram stories, or even TikTok, whatever tickles your fancies. So yes, this is an audio test and also a video test on the front camera on the S24. Test 1-2, test 1-2, test 1-2. Another test I wanted to do is the wind test on the audio, right? So I'm using the rear camera on the S24 right now. It is like super windy, so hopefully the audio is better, even though in a very windy situation. So you can see it is pretty windy over here, so hopefully it sounds better. If it does or if it does not, let me know in the comment section below. So how is it? Now, if you guys are enjoying this kind of video, do give this video a nice big thumbs up, and a subscription would be lovely too. Thank you very much in advance. And speaking of sample photos, if you want to show off your photos that you take on your phone, head to our Discord server where I leave links down below, and let's discuss it over there too. Now, performance is key, and in short, the Exynos chipset did not disappoint. Now, just like how I said in my review of the S23 FE, I don't get the hate that the chipset gets, because honestly, I had zero issues when I was using this phone, and including the S23 FE, and now with this new Exynos 2400 on this S24 as well. So there are three main areas where the chipset really shows its capability. First is the image processing, as you saw in the photos and videos earlier, so enough said about that. Then number two is the thermal performance, because the phone stayed cool all the way, whether or not it's multitasking, opening several apps and navigating between them. But where it only became just a bit warm is when I was shooting at 8K 30fps, and that is because of the temperature here in Malaysia is not the coolest, right? And I was taking those shots in 8K in a very bright sunlight. Then the final place where the phone really shines is in the gaming performance, where I tested Genshin Impact, and I'll put the exact settings at the screen right now, where there was no lag or any stutters, just a tiny bit warmth near the camera bump area during a very long gameplay, and that's it. So is there a problem with the Exynos 2400 chipset? Absolutely not, my friend. Now onto the battery. The phone's 25 watts fast charging and wireless charging is still here because the rear is a matte frosted glass. So once again, there's no compromise on that on this particular S24 model. Now I was a little skeptical about the 4000 milliamps of battery, as that might not be enough to last the day. But the good news is that it did, where I got a total of 7 hours plus when I was at 15% battery with dark mode turned on, with heavy gaming and lots of video consumption too. Now as for longevity purposes, it's nice that there is the battery protection menu to ensure that you never overcharge the phone, where I left mine at adaptive during my 1 month of use. But when I'm traveling, I just switch it to basic to get the best amount of battery life possible. Now if you want a recap of everything mentioned in this video, there is a written version of this whole video at our website at www.adamlobo.tv, so check that out, links will be down below. Now, software-wise, it is rocking the new One UI version 6.1 on top of Android 14, bringing you all the latest features and promising a long-term support up to 7 years of software update. Now, One UI version 6.1 is hands down my favorite Android skin, and it has been for many people as well. And I genuinely love that experience during my 1 month of use. And since Samsung DeX is also supported in this S24, hence you're getting an even smaller, super portable device that is also very versatile to bring with you everywhere. So to wrap up, the Samsung Galaxy S24 is a solid choice for anyone looking for a compact, feature-packed and flagship smartphone. Now give it a little time for the price to just maybe go down a little, then this will be your next phone, since it is small yet mighty, because not everyone needs or can afford an Ultra. But if you're wondering about the S24 Ultra, check out my in-depth review of that over here.